the rest of you have it, right? So come and start, you know, just meet me, come by in my office anytime you see me, and let's start firming them up, right? Now, those of you who have done the class before know the drill. I need to start seeing your Google document with proposal going up there, and all the stuff, right? I think all of you have taken the class other than Swapnil. So everybody else have done the class before. Oh, okay, and Michael. So, but in your case, then if you're doing alone, then talk to me. Otherwise, the person you are going to collaborate with, they would know what the drill. That way, we can save the time and repetition. All right. There you go. Let's start.
language of the France will not be really interested for a user who is looking for this particular person. So he wanted to identify like what would be the important subgraph that will be relevant to the user. So in order to do that, he used the graph algorithms, breadth first and depth first, and refine the results with the user and then give the desired result for the user. So then this is how he presented the result. So this is the result that is generally given by the Google search engine, and this is the result that he came up with by looking at the RDA for the semantic web data. So he presented both the results at the same time. So as of now, there are so many semantic web data search engines which runs in more scalable way than this, called Syntis, Sigma, and so on. So now we come to the things that we have right now. I think we have discussed a whole about the knowledge graph. So now once we type something in the Google, Google will search through the knowledge graph, and then it will give this, in addition to the results that they earlier presented to us, they'll present this results which has the properties of this particular person, and with the description maybe extracted from Wikipedia, and these are the properties associated with this particular entity, and these are the other values associated with this property. And at the same time, he'll give some, the search engine will give some relevant related results that you can go and study further about this particular entity. So this Google Knowledge Graph, as they say right now, it consists of 570 million objects and 18 million facts, and it is built from these three datasets: Freebase, Wikipedia, and CIA Factbook. So in addition to that, recently they announced that they are using some medical data as well. So now once you search for a particular drug, I think they are giving more informative information than before. But they didn't reveal like exactly what kind of dataset that they are using. They're just saying, okay, we are using medical datasets as well. So I want to point out one important point. Both these two databases, knowledge sources, Freebase and Wikipedia, those two knowledge sources are describe things in a very general nature. And the most important thing about both of these knowledge sources are they are driven by the community. And we go to the Wikipedia and we update the pages in the Wikipedia, and then the search engines are using those information to build these kind of search engines. So by having idea about this kind of a thing, it clearly points out that nobody in this world cannot build the whole knowledge by them alone. So it is the community who asks, we go to these knowledge sources and we update the information, and the search engines are utilizing it much better now. So now instead of strings, it will give us the entities, and it allows us to find the right thing, and we get the best summary out of it. And also, as we like, we can go deeper or broader to further investigate these entities. So now they are doing something for the examples that we discussed in the class, that when a particular entity have different meaning in the different context. So now Google Knowledge Graph, for example, if we search for the Taj Mahal, so in addition to give this historical building in India, it will also give, okay, there's a casino resort called Taj Mahal, and also there's a musician with the name Taj Mahal. So with the main results as this, they provide these two results which help users to find more information, or if search engine did not get us the right, if we are really looking for this musician, it will allow us to particularly identify that. So now, just to have a small discussion, I would like to get your ideas from how, because they didn't reveal every information that how this knowledge graph is working. So as in the early example, we saw that in the Guha's work, he completely looked for the entities only in the semantic web data sets. So either the Google knowledge graph is doing the same thing, or you just get the results from the Google and then get the top results out of the search and then identify the entity in the knowledge source. So we really don't know what they are doing exactly. If you guys have any idea, you can share with us. If not, we can continue. But one more thing need to be really improved in these search engine is the relationship aspect, because if you want to know how Amit Chetty and Jim Handler are related, currently we don't have a good way to identify that. Certainly it needs to be improved, and with their discussions we can get idea they are really working on these aspects as well. So all together, when we look at these major search engines, they are really moving towards to using the background knowledge, and then they are trying to discover the relationship of this particular entity to other entities to get the relevant other results. And one of the major initiatives that happened maybe 2 years back, 1 year back, would be introduction of the schema.org. So schema.org is a vocabulary that is agreed by three major search engines, Google, Yahoo, and Bing. And they agreed to use this schema.org as a common vocabulary or as a domain model to use in their search engines. So by that time, there was a really good discussions about this schema.org, and people started to annotate their web pages using the schema.org concepts, annotate their documents with the concepts in the schema.org. But unfortunately, as of now, we really cannot see whether these search engines are really using them or not. So we are still waiting to see whether something is happening or not. Okay, so now generally if we discuss what are the technologies that we have seen in these search engines, so we clearly know that the statistical techniques still play the very big role in these search engines. So starting from the early ages, the vector space model, and even right now we have a very high importance to the co-occurrence techniques and as well, and especially when it comes to ranking also, the statistical techniques still play a very big role. And also the machine learning approaches like classification, clustering kind of thing, and also natural language processing, especially since we are moving from the search to the question and answering, NLP technique also will be very important, and also the semantic web and knowledge representation and reasoning kind of stuff. But whatever the technology you are using, scalability will always be a matter. So unless you have a very scalable solution that can address these factors, these things, none of these techniques will not be useful if they are not really scalable. So now I would like to discuss maybe at least a few points that we discussed earlier in the presentation. So we introduced some factors that we would like to see in search engines, and I would like to discuss what kind of techniques that we discussed earlier can be used in these cases. For example, if I take the question and answering search. So as we know, when we have a question and answering search, basically we'll have the question in the natural language. So we need NLP techniques to convert that question post in the natural language to some structured form. So natural language processing will play a role there. And then also with respect to the text corpus, maybe we need to use some machine learning techniques for the, maybe for example, we have some query and then we go to the text and we identify some possible candidates, and then in order to identify the best or the best candidate, we might have some features, and then using those features we might need to use machine learning techniques and so on. And also, especially since now we are dealing with the entities, the knowledge sources and the relevant information will be important, and we might need semantic web for those aspects. So if you guys would like to discuss other information as well, we can go through if you are interested. That's fine. Okay, so now let's discuss some of the major search engines that we have right now. So we have Google, Bing, and Yahoo. So I would like to know your idea, because we are going to do a comparison anyway of the search engines. Where Google plays a very good role, and how Bing is compared with Google, and what is the role Yahoo is playing. Yes.
So as of, are you talking?
No.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
So as of today, I think Google has the capability for question answering queries, for responding to question answering queries, like if I were to type what is the distance between Dayton and Columbus, I get a map with the actual distance.
Yeah.
Bing does not give that. It just gives links of articles which are discussing the distance between Dayton and Columbus.
But one more difference, like but Google, like in near future, they are going to launch the knowledge graph also. Right now, Bing has only like categorized search, like if you have related query, like.
Yeah, so,
so
I think.
Right now, I don't know if they are working on that part of the entity, but
I think both, like all the three search engines, they have some kind of a knowledge base that they are utilizing. For example, for fact, we know that Google is using the Google Knowledge Graph, and Freebase is using, Bing is using Freebase data. To identify tools for the entities. And Yahoo, they have something called Probase that is developed by them, and this is something very specific for the natural language, as a natural language search for the search queries. So they are building this knowledge source called Probase. And in the Bing case as well, I think they acquired PowerSet. I think it is also a search engine which really focuses on natural, question answering search engine or something like that. So all the three major engines, they are thinking of moving to entities, not just the keyword, and using utilizing the existing knowledge sources, or building their own knowledge sources by collecting all the existing information. So I think that is.
Do you find Yahoo uses Probase or plans to use Probase?
I mean, Probase is the search, I mean the knowledge sources that they are planning to utilize, I guess.
Yeah.
I have read it in some article.
I thought the, are you talking about the one from Microsoft research in Beijing?
Yeah, I think.
That is Bing, right? But I don't, they are not trying to use that in Bing.
But now, actually Yahoo is powered by Bing, right?
Yeah. I have not heard anywhere. So if you see that, I would love to see that.
Yeah, I think I have a link that side.
I think actually building this tree, if you want to really rating or just say choice, Google and Bing, they claim that they are smart semantic search engine. But Yahoo didn't really claim that, right? All of the factors you just you questioned in the previous page is for Google and Bing.
I think one of the interesting factors about Yahoo is that since they have their like movie information, their videos, their sport information, so they try to provide some integrated search using those things as well. So that is one thing that I can see in Yahoo. But I accept the fact that Google and Bing are the very big players in the search engine.
Especially for the semantic
point
of
view. Yep. Well, you notice, right? Bing has the categories in the top, and within the category, its search interpretation, query interpretation are different.
Well, the whole, I think, for the category that you pick, it is using different background information.
Yeah,
as well as it is using a different contextual interpretation of query. So for example, if there is a World Cup going on, and you go to sports, it's going to highlight the results right at the top, latest results at the top. Other uniqueness would be that because of the special arrangement with Facebook, Bing made Microsoft made an investment in Facebook a while ago. They are going to bring in more Facebook relevant social data in their search results.
And of course, Google will do it for Google Plus. And that, again, so in case of Google, for example, you do a search on a flight, it's going to give you the latest flight status as an example. So engines are, you know, putting more and more structured databases. How are they doing? They're basically calling an API and getting the information on that. But before they do that, they need to know that this particular syntax and say this particular strings actually relate to flight. When you say DL2039, the DL is for Delta 2039. The flights are either 3 or 4 digit codes. It can be 2 actually also, but then typically 0 before that. Then it knows that it is a flight and it is going to use that particular information. So they are doing kind of a real time access of third party information to integrate as you know. And they are doing the reviews and many other things. So each of them are bringing semantics in different ways, structured data in different ways, their BBIs in different ways, and all of them are forms of semantics because they're going beyond the syntax.
And if Yahoo is powered by Bing, what's the point of having like the two search engines separately? I mean, because if it is powered by Bing, then we should see the same results in both Yahoo and Bing. But sometimes it is not the case.
Yeah, it is not. So each search engine may add some value in it. So, for example, Yahoo may its own have Yahoo organizes around its property. The Yahoo's corporate background is centered around content, creating original content, or in so Yahoo is organized around properties called finance.yahoo.com, auto, and Yahoo is a separate group on automobiles, a separate group on movies and music. Music is a separate thing on Yahoo. In fact, many times their groups don't talk to each other. And the portals, these are all different portals. They are implemented differently. For example, finance was one of the earliest ones to use RDF technology underneath. And that was an example that showed that indeed RDF technology can scale enough to power such a large website. You know, how many, what is it does it? Even if it's not anywhere close to Google, it is still quite a few. Even if it's an order of magnitude smaller than Google, it's still significant number of queries that it is doing. So then it has also then the ability to use additional information or knowledge that they have that is not part of Bing, for example. So there is additional customization that can be done. Furthermore, like when we did our Tali search engine, we had a specialized ranking algorithm. When we found if you ask for a query and the query term was in context, let's say, of an actor, then the semantics was very precise. And we knew how to rank. And further on in the ranking, we also would know, say that if the data are coming from this source, it would be higher rank because that's typically what consumers seem to prefer. Or this is, if for example, if I know that the content that is being written in the query result is baseball, and the data is coming from MLB.com, I will rank it high, right? Because it's contextually relevant, it's a more authoritative site. So we also had those notions. We also had a simple key box search, meaning you don't have to have faceted search. And then when you use that, just like a keyword search, that means you're not telling the search engine that it is an actor or something, it's just a string. But then when we match it against something very concrete in our ontology, then we give it higher priority. And when that particular query term was part of a specific metadata that we extracted, it gives higher priority versus if it was in the plain text of the, let's say first paragraph of the page on which we had an object. Then it was a part of text. That means we did not have enough context to know for sure that it is a Madonna, as in this Madonna or that, or this role or that role. Right? So in that context, then we would rank it lower. So we had different search ranking strategy, you know, strategy. That ranking strategy was different, let's say, from Google ranking page rank, because we had the knowledge of schema, we had the knowledge of extraction, which was semantic extraction. We had knowledge of semantic enhancement, which was enhancement done by our system by using ontology. So all that allowed us to give different priorities to the search results, and it was more, I guess, in certain level, some way more sophisticated, some way less. Thing. Yahoo has seems the same way option of bringing in more data in that context, let's say finance, and interpret the query in a particular way. For example, the fact that somebody does a query from finance.yahoo.com, let's say suppose Yahoo used Bing for finance and sports and everything, but suppose because you know that the query is launched from this particular part of the Yahoo portal, the context is very clear, the domain is clear, then Yahoo is free to further adjust the rank. So the search engines do provide, even though Bing is there in the background and Google could be in the background, they could provide their partners here, because it's not like a general search engine. Yeah. They would provide the partners to customize it, their ranking. Yahoo may also want to tweak the search results such that if there are relevant results on Yahoo's properties, they will be automatically boosted higher, because they want to highlight the content. Because what happens when you give the results, and when the user clicks on the results, that is the monetization, because when the user clicks on the results, the page will be rendered. On that page, there are advertisements. If it's a banner advertisement, then they can make money. If it's a link-based thing where click-based advertisement, then it is, if you click on that, then you make money. But actually, search engine develop algorithms to know what is the probability of making money on each of the links at each of the location, rank, right? So they would want to then do optimization to say, even if I don't give you the very best results, let's say, my result from Yahoo property may be not the best as result from some third party party, but my chance of making more money multiplied by the lower probability is still higher, I would boost up the result as an example, right? So these are the variety of strategies that constantly go on to tweak the search results, and hence you will see the different results for many different ways.
Then we'll discuss some of the upcoming search engines. So I have included some from the link Mary shared into the community group. So this is one that it was not there in the list, called Ball from Alpha. And they answer factual queries. The interestingness of the results is their search results is structured. So for example, in this case, I searched for Barack Obama, and they give the results in a very structured form. Also, they have the ability to interpret the question that we are posing, and this is the question that I was using, and they give their interpretation of the input that we had. So I was searching for how old was Queen Elizabeth II in 1974, and the search engine interpret the question, okay, age of Queen Elizabeth II in 1974. So as you can see, it identified. They might use the age to figure it out, and they identified, okay, by saying old, I means the age, and then the entity and the category that entity belongs to, and then, so after that, it will give me the completely the answer, 47 years from the search engine. So this is something that I saw in this search engine. And I think this one, we saw it in the into three groups called regular search, surface semantic, and deep semantics. So in the regular search, it will search for images, video, videos and Twitters. And in the surface semantic, basically it search for the whole web, and it can categorize the news differently and the blog documents differently. And when it comes to deep semantic, it uses some existing knowledge sources like PubMed to answer the queries. So you can select whatever the type that you want when you type a query over there. So depending on the type you selected out of these three, the results will be a little different. So if we select PubMed, the results will be more related to the PubMed articles. So this is some feature that they had. And they use Wikipedia, as they have mentioned in the document. And also they have some trusted knowledge sources which they would like to rank higher. For example, if you have some article from PubMed or some known location, they will rank it higher. So this is that search engine called Hakia. And then this is another thing called Kjin. So this one basically for the web for image results. And they also use a concept base which has 8 million concepts. But this seems not to be free. Interesting other search engines that you would like to discuss? So I just listed earlier and I didn't have a very thorough look at these search engines. If you find anything interesting, we can discuss.
DuckDuckGo. DuckDuckGo uses Wolfram Alpha.
Yeah,
the search engine you discuss.
So in there, I think they provided like different categories. So when we say Apple, they specifically gave it for that. When we say Apple, they say the fruit company, and they categorize
there's
it.
There's a filter in the right at the beginning.
Yes.
When you
yes.
put a thing, you get a filter at the beginning itself, so that, like Shreyansh was saying, I don't want to look at 15 different palms. It gives you, as you put a palm, it will give you a filter right at the beginning, so that you can directly
yes.
look at what you want.
Is it?
Yeah, I'm just wondering, what's the benefit of having so many different search engines besides?
They change their ranking order based on the type of the search. Or if it is a regular, they'll have a different ranking methodology. If it is from PubMed, they will use a different ranking methodology. So I think sometimes it is based on the purpose. So for example, I read in one article of that the search engine, this one. So in their case, they are customizing it for different customers as they need. For example, in the same way that his search engine had earlier, how they get the competitive competitors' information, like how they get the every update that their competitors have. So some of them have very focused aims like that as well to serve their customers. So that can be one. And I think from all mobile aspect of the search.
So mobile search, Dr. Chef in the first class had some better stats. I found this online, but it's just basically saying the percentage of users who are using the mobile web, their mobile device, for their only means of search is keeps growing, you know, especially among younger users, but then also older users as well. I know at least in my family and my wife's family, who've never used a desktop computer or a laptop, were kind of scared of it, but you know, they all have iPads now, and they're doing email and searching Google and buying things online, so it's more and more important. So in the framework of, you know, context-aware mobile search, so your phone can give you, can provide some of these search engines with more context as to, you know, maybe your search history or your location, what you're doing, and there are a lot, if you go to the IEEE or the Wright State search, you can look on here, and there are lots of articles and new patents being put out all the time, and these are just a couple of samples right there if you want to look further, but I thought instead of going over those, I was at a conference over the summer, and they had actually talked about some of the stuff, and I thought was really relevant, so I thought I'd spend a little bit of time talking about that instead of going over just some articles we read. But basically, there was a design group in Columbus, and they pitched to Vans.com. I don't know if everybody knows Vans or not, but they do like skateboarding stuff, snowboarding stuff. And their demographic with Vans in particular is that they're sort of they cater to a younger demographic, so people who are more likely to use mobile devices and searching while they're on the go. And the unfortunate thing is if you go to their website from your iPhone or you go to it from a desktop computer, it's the same thing, just sort of scaled down. So these guys were pitching a redesign of Vans.com, and then they were using a lot of the things in their pitch that we've been talking about in class. So for example, you know, Vans, they do skateboarding and snowboarding. So one of the things they talked a lot about was, you know, if your location, if you're in Denver in the mountains, you probably want to default to like their snowboarding stuff right off the bat instead of making their users click through to get to that section of the site. Or if they're out on a beach, you could show the surf stuff. Or you know, if you're in the middle of the city, maybe default to the skateboarding stuff. And then going further and using personalization stuff too, because these users tend to, you know, if I'm a skateboarder, you know, maybe I don't want to see some of the other stuff. So these guys were pitching that, and this is a concrete example of, you know, I know we've talked a lot about, you know, searching ontologies and what, you know, we discussed a little bit on the Google community what the end goal is, but this is a concrete example of sort of semantic. There's no difference. This is just using additional context, I guess, to sort of cater the experience to a specific user. So, you know, your phone knows a lot about you, your location, it knows, and they even discuss, you know, the weather, right? So if it's a sunny day out, you're near a beach, and maybe you want to see their surfing-related stuff. So this is all catering the content, because, right, you have limited space on a mobile device, so you really want to, you know, show the users what they want up front. And personally, I think that that's true on a desktop site too, but you know, it's even more critical for a small handheld device.
You get your personal information from your phone.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah. So one of the search engines that we were talking about earlier, the one that's iPhone app, you know, I pulled it up on my phone and right off the bat it asked me my location, the K engine one. So, you know, that's a good example too of you know, and so I searched for Skyline on it, right? And so it's, you know, shows me the nearest Skyline restaurants, but you know, maybe if it didn't have my location information it might have searched for, you know, Skyline images or something else.
So I think that is the idea of Siri as well, right? So rather than a generic search engine, Siri thinks that it is you as a personal assistant. So it knows your context better than a search engine would know what you do. So I think that might be the idea. That's what I think Siri is trying to do. Contextual information about us.
Okay, so three more discussions.
Move for anyone.
Okay, the final thing that we are going to talk about.
In little mobile, just an idea actually, might be wrong. Like, can we use, like, there are a lot of people, billions of people are using smartphone right now. So can't we use the mobile phone for storing the, about the users, like what they are doing activities or the search, like create a user model and do a better search kind of thing. Like.
Yeah, I think so.
So
I think
it could be a better, like a widget. To store the about activities of users or like what they search about and what's happening in their mobile. So we can create a user model according to that and make more search for.
Yeah, I think you know, and it combines with sort of the knowledge graph on the back end, and then the more context you can send along with the search queries. Like you know, if I'm searching for something at 11 o'clock during the day, you know, it'd be nice if my phone knew that, all right, this guy's out and about, he's away from his desk, and it's 11 o'clock, he's looking for some place to eat, versus, you know, showing me a bunch of other junk that it doesn't know.
Like, even like if they share their information with Google, so when you will search in Google also, you get the same result as that. You don't need to have a specific search engine. I don't know.
Yeah, it'd be great. I think we're moving to that too. You know, Google's adding more stuff.
If you look at the emerging search engines, one of the main features that we saw was that they try to cater the question and answering facility. So rather than just typing a keyword and search, now the search is changing from keyword to question answering. So people try to be more innovative in finding to give the answer for the question you have. So according to Google Knowledge Graph, the people who is working on the Google Knowledge Graph as well, their next step is to how we can utilize the questions posed by the users to give the right answer. Mm-hmm. So when we talk about the question answering area, the IBM Watson play a very big role in that. So IBM Watson compete with the human in the Japanese quiz show, so it's an American quiz show, and Watson had the capability to compete with all the best human players in the competition, and it won from the competition. So they didn't reveal much information about their architecture and so on, but this is something that you can see from the Wikipedia page. So what they try to do is they get the question and they analyze the question. So basically they might have been using the NLP techniques over here, and they try to decompose the question into small sub-questions. So if you see the questions that we posed in the previous search engines, they are quite simple in the structure in its way. For example, we can say, what is the temperature? So it's known that this is a what type of question, and he's looking for the temperature. But there can be more complex question rather than that. Probably, give me an actor who is acted in a film which is not directed by himself. So that kind of a question will be really, there are so many disambiguation steps to be done and identify like particular sub part of the questions. So the special thing about IBM Watson, it is really doing it very
then decompose the query into subparts. And then, so one of the other special thing is, by the time that Watson is trying to find the answer, he is not connected to the online. So he is offline, but he has the kind of knowledge sources that it already gathered. So it has the access to it, but not he is not currently going to the online and search everything. So when he had that kind of a knowledge, it is searching from all there. And then based on those knowledge sources, it tried to generate some hypothesis. And then from that hypothesis, it tried to filter the data. And then they try to score those hypotheses based on the evidence that they have. So even for considering that evidence, they use the information in the knowledge sources. And then they try to combine the answers that they got, and then using some machine learning learning models to identify the best answer and give the confidence. So while comparing the traditional question answering stuff and this one is, so one of the earliest question answering system was trying to get the question and then try to convert the question into a structured form and then look for the databases which has the structured knowledge and give the answer. But instead, Watson is really dealing with unstructured text. But the special thing is when it comes to, so first of all, looking at the structured, so I don't know every nitty-gritty details about the Watson, but I'm saying from the conversation that we had earlier from those things. So we generate some hypothesis based on the unstructured text, and when it comes to filtering and scoring the these hypotheses, it is really using the knowledge sources and the type information over there. For example, since I'm working on linked open data, they claim that they are using linked open data. So in that case, they said they are not just searching the entities in the linked open data. So once they identify some hypothesis or some possible candidates for the given question, then they try to identify the proper candidate by limiting the type of the that candidate answer can be. So this is something really different when comparing with the existing question answering systems. So that is what Watson is trying to do, and it seems that they are now moving to the medical domain as well. Yes?
So till now, other search engines don't have any offline database, knowledge base, like as IBM Watson using the offline.
No, database. So like when normal search engine would go, for example, let's say Google. So Google have some kind of an index structure. So it crawls the web. So for example, let's say today they crawl the web, and maybe 1 week later they crawl the web again. So they crawl the web and they find the web and they structure all the information by basically using the keywords and maybe using some other.
So they keep all those information somewhere offline in the database, right?
So they have stored there along with the documents and the keywords they are using. So the special thing about this case is the idea is in the same way as a human, me, I am using my brain or the knowledge that I learned earlier to give an answer. So it is the same thing that Watson is trying to do. So that's why it is not allowing the Watson to go and look for the answers in the online right now. So it only uses the collected knowledge that it did earlier. So that is the idea why it is not going online and searching. And I think it is because of that this is very scalable. The most surprising thing that we saw in the Watson is the fast response time that it had. So all the other techniques that we saw in one way or the other in our areas, but none of those techniques were that much scalable as we saw it. But surprisingly, they were really fast and they were able to figure it out very quickly.
The guy who gave the presentation talked about the web a little bit. And he said that one of the reasons they didn't use web was, for one, because it was, you're not allowed to be connected to the internet for the competition.
Yes.
But also, they chose to use a smaller database so that it's quicker searching. Because if they were to use the whole web in their database, then they'd be searching however many billion bytes of data there is, or billion gigabytes. But so that the way that they picked their data sources was actually kind of clever, so that they picked a really small data source, but it had a lot of good information that helped them kind of search quickly. but he talked about it a little bit. Instead of using, you know, the big data source, they strategically picked a small source that they could do.
So one of the like leading persons who worked in the IBM Watson project, Chris Welty, so he's coming to Wright State in 10th of February. In case if you guys would like to participate, that would be interesting. So the last thing that I wanted to point out is how the search engines try to use the social data. So we saw in one article that Facebook is also trying to come into the search area. So, and at the same time, Google launched Google Plus to collect our profile information. So Facebook is going to Yahoo. So we can see that there's a lot of things going on to collect the user's information based on the social media that we have. And we, even though we didn't discuss a whole lot, search on multimedia, that means the images and the videos will be really interesting. And at the same time, like when we had the first discussion of the class, the searching of on stream data also will be really interesting. Finally, I finished it. Thank you.
Sir, see, like I have a question. Since all of these search engines and all, they're using ontologies, right? And there is a limitation of how, like, the scale in terms of scalability and all, to reason over the ontology. Like, at till particular level, you can reason over ontology, and after that, it is not scalable enough, or it is not possible to reason using ontology. Are there any statistics of saying that till this boundary level, we can use ontology till this level, and we cannot use it after that?
To be honest, I don't know that kind of a study, but I think ontology is in the more realistic way in the search engines. They are not using really reasoning. I mean, reasoning as we have seen in the semantic web, because it is so expensive. I think ontology, they are using it as a way to represent the domain, maybe to identify the vocabularies for the disambiguation purposes and so on. Other than that, Dr. Do you aware of any, like, are we using really ontology reasoning in the search? I mean,
nobody's, what do you mean by reasoning?
Reasoning as we, not your reasoning, the formal semantic web reasoning.
No, there is nothing that fails at that level. So, first of all, that is a non-starter. Second is, I think what the form of reasoning that is going to be used is chasing the a link, basically, connecting a link. Very simple, very short graph-based thing is what is likely to be done. Nobody is going to do a three-hop graph computation. One or two hop is good. And noticing that the two things are explicitly connected and connected by a particular level, these kind of things can be used. Sometime in future, perhaps graph-based reasoning or graph-based computations will come along more and more. And there may be some to some level now, but not much. So, but as informal, no, because expressing any fact informal. So here is an interesting example. For all those people who work on first order logic kind of thing, there was an attempt, or actually work that somebody did to describe Tim Berners-Lee's trip to I guess this place in Austria, I believe, I forget now. Innsbruck. And it took them 7 pages to actually formally define the trip, on which then you potentially would do reasoning to help him find, you know, the results, right? So who in the right mind on things related to web is going to write about one specific scenario, 7 pages worth of formal description, right? So trying to formally model something, and when it takes an expert in formal language to describe a
trip from A to B in 7 pages is not something that's going to start, right? Maybe there will be some techniques to automatically convert, let's say, some database into some representation on which you can apply some reasoning. For example, we can talk about reasoning of a form like you are doing partonomy related reasoning, or you are doing transitive closure related things, where there is a lot of work.
And rule based kind of can be used in AI extensively.
Yes, but then not at the very large scale. So again, it's possible that we may do some limited form of rule-based computation in a very specific domain, let's say.
Yeah.
Okay. So suppose you wanted to capture certain information that under certain diagnosis, only certain diseases are, symptoms, certain diagnosis, and you correlate them and model that as some sort of rules, that's possible. But it will be kind of very well targeted situation and limited scenario, but not something kind of on the web. So if somebody claimed, as in the recipe tomorrow, claimed that ontologies won't be used in the form of using formal languages and for representation of ontologies and then reasoning using logic-based reasoners, then yes, he's right. That's not going to happen, at least not anywhere in the web. But the form of reasoning in broad sense is making associations, making connections, finding things that occur more often with this thing, and then making a judgment, trying to label the relationships, make a label graph, and then traverse that in a limited way. Those kind of stuff are likely to happen, and people are going to use it. If you notice that in Google, for example, they don't use RDF. They say we have links. They say strings and links. In fact, they even avoided, I believe, word relationship, which is potentially loaded term also for them. So make it simple right now. But so people will go along that line. But the first, I think, place where the semantics that will come in is by explicitly involving links in the computation. That's what I think. Okay. All right. So are you done with this topic?
Yes.
All right. So we can take the applause here. All right. So next, chapter 7.
Semantics of social data. evolution of social data, the differences between Web 2.0, Web 3.0, and how that relates to social data. Some challenges that arise in social data, given this user-generated content instead of professional-generated content. And then we'll talk about the nature, the disadvantages and advantages, and then model takeover, do semantics in social media, and some examples and apps that are built. So evolution of social data. So in Web 1.0, we see here that it's mainly producer making the content and then the consumer reading it. So it's kind of a read-only web. And then we evolved to Web 2.0, getting some new technologies like XML, Ajax, JavaScript stuff. So it allowed for easy for people to produce and share their information. So you see here we have people connected, sharing information, and also producing it, not just the producer and consumer. And then as we move on to Web 3.0, we want to have applications built on analyzing documents produced by consumers and their users, instead of just sharing and reading and producing. Web 3.0, we use knowledge bases and ontologies in document level metadata, and through these, it'll help us to better organize and analyze social media content. So we can use knowledge bases to base what our posts and stuff are about. We can compare it to other stuff in the knowledge bases to get us relevant information. Now we're going to talk about the disadvantages of social data, which is UGC, user-generated content. First thing, it's ubiquitous, meaning there's a lot of it, and it's consistently coming. So this is just kind of some numbers showing how much data is coming in. This one, really importantly, is tweets per day. It's about 50 million tweets per day, so that's a lot of data coming in. And we have the teen problem, that's kind of how we're phrasing it, is the informal and mediated kind of text that the teens produce. So these are some examples. It uses slang and slurs and a lot of very terse language. And it's not formal grammar, so we can't use the natural language parsers that we would normally use to analyze this text. And also what goes along with that is the Twitter problem. And Twitter's limitation to use only 140 characters makes the post more terse, maybe minimal queue. And we can't identify the theme using the natural language parsers. So we have to use knowledge bases to get the relevant context. We have to use some theme identifying technologies. We'll talk about those later. So if it's tricky and messy and hard to read, then why do we want to use it? Here's an example of a post given by some guy that says, the situation on the ground in Egypt is very tense. The vehicle I was in was attacked and my window was smashed. So what this is kind of a real-time personal perception of an event given in this region. So what this is good for is we have the geospatial location of where this was posted. It was posted using a mobile phone. And we have the time it was posted, which is recorded here. And it's kind of a personal perception of this event. So we have, instead of getting maybe a feed from a news event, we have this personal thing that tells what happened, so we get kind of this semantic description of this event. Another thing we can do with this data is we can take kind of consensus extraction. So this here is, you can't really read it, but it goes from a starting date to an ending date, and it shows the change in consensus for the polls. this is Obama versus Romney, and maybe it was over some debate or something that happened. So it shows how the data changed based on social media extraction. So that's kind of a consensus thing we can do with the data. And this is a cool topic here, citizen sensing. What citizen sensing is imagining that everybody in the world is a sensor, given that they have a mobile phone, and they can observe and report observations using this, so they act as a sensor in the universe. So our phones now, we all know they have cameras, they have GPS, they have internet connection. So using these, we can develop thematic, spatial, and temporal data to get this application situation awareness, which is perception of environmental elements with respect to time, space, and theme.
So there is a lot more to this picture. I think we should.
I'll analyze this.
Huh?
I'll analyze this.
You? Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. So here we have the camera, which gives us thematics of the data, and also the text that we send is the theme based. The GPS gives us the spatial location. It provides the latitude and longitude data. And then we can send this to the internet. And when it's posted, we get the temporal data as it's recorded on social websites. So this is an example which is given in the book and also on the Noesis citizen sensing webpage. So here we have a photo and some tweets that were given during the Mumbai attacks. And so this photo, which has metadata of latitude and longitude, as we talked, gives it to a reverse geocoder, and we get an address which is near this, which is right here, the house. And then using this other service, we can get relevant locations like this Sound House and Income Tax Office. So we have kind of a spatial analysis there. And then using the tweets, we have the temporal analysis based on the time that it gives us, time and date. And then by analyzing what's in the tweet, using these semantic models, we can also get more thematic analysis. So we get a whole semantic model within this little application here, situational awareness. So this could be used, say, or some kind of application, maybe a help application. So you can see that there's this event that happened, and we can analyze it automatically, and then use it for a better application to get help to the situation or something.
So, I think this, I don't know when you get to the list. The important thing here is that the social media text is hard to understand, right? I mean, ultimately it comes down to content of the social media. If all you're talking about is the location or time, that's one thing, that's fine. So it is easy to ask the question, show me, if there is an event occurring in this location, show me tweets all around that place. That's something you can do. It's, you know, relatively easy from a computational perspective. But the understanding of social media text, the tweets particularly, given that this so-called user-generated content, UGC, because these are not full sentences, traditional parsing techniques don't work, and I think that they would show you by example. But the point here is that here you have a word, Nariman. What does that mean? Right? And understanding Nariman as in looking at the location of the tweet, trying to find the objects near that, for example, from a database, let's say all the buildings, and having found there something called the Nariman House, and to then try to kind of make a connection that maybe the Nariman is Nariman House. That is a kind of unfair, that is a kind of thing that you need to do, use of background knowledge to help understand the text. That is the unique thing that you can do. And that is where
the real semantic issue is coming from, the real semantic capability is coming from. There is one level of semantics where you are combining spatiotemporal thematic information. It is semantic because there are different aspects of it. There's a model of an event. An event has time, space, location, and the topic, thematic element. And then you can say, okay, that is, because you have a model, that is a form of semantics. The other form of semantics here is that I want to understand and do semantic information extraction or semantic notation of the tweets. If you are using pure lexical technique and the guy has capitalized N, that helps you. Something, that's probably a noun. If you want to. But then what kind of object it is? That's the thing that machine can easily make of, right? Here, NSG. Right? Here, Taj, I believe. Well, what is Taj? Right? And to know contextually that maybe this is Taj Mahal Hotel. Right? There are many Taj, there are many forms of Taj, right? So playing off the three dimensions here with each other, spatio-temporal thematic, further using one of them to create additional background knowledge, as in looking up, using a web service, what are the buildings nearby, what are the locations nearby. These days there is lot more government, open government data, lot of data on leak open data also. As an example, we are looking at Hurricane Sandy, and we could find that there is an open government site from New York City and New York State, which gives you addresses of each of the subway entrances. Right? So suppose I got a tweet, it has a location, and suppose I am interested in studying the subway tunnel flooding. Then for me to use locational information to find whether there are subway entrances nearby. There are many ways water can go, but one way it can go is through these openings. Right? So then creating the background knowledge on the fly, if possible, using the API, because all this data is available through API, well-defined API. And then from there saying, well, locations, the name. Oh, this is the address for this particular 52 and street and other kind of whatever avenue entrance. That's what it says, let's say. Okay. Then using that to understand, somebody might have tweeted there is a water, this particular subway station is flooded. How would you understand that is the name of a subway location? Well, you'll have to go and get some of the information somewhere else, right? So trying to make this dynamic on the fly, online, semantic associations between the data and not just the things that are available to us from the tweets, from the text, but even going and getting something from Wikipedia, getting something from link open data, getting something from open government data website, that getting something from weather sensor data, right? Is the road I see in that time. That this is what, there are some unique approaches for that. This is not easy, but this is the kind of possibilities that are there. And these are very unique, these are a very good example of really what is semantic. This is what really gives the meaning. As opposed to, oh, there is a word called Nariman that occurs all the time. Well, so what? Right? In fact, the important thing here is that not only that, but you know that Nariman House is actually the place where there is this Jewish center. Because this terrorist wanted to hurt not just India, but also Jews. Right? So to know that, and then making this connection here, well, there's a mention of Jew. Well, what is the connection there? Right? That is the semantic thing.
So I'm going to back up a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
we talked about there being a difference between the formal data and then user-generated content. And the point we really want to make is that the reason it's so much different is that we can't really use the natural language parsers to figure out what the context of the, or what the thematics of the post is. So we need to really rely on knowledge bases as opposed to natural language parser to figure out what it's about and figure out what entities in the post are about, which ones are relative. So because of these problems, we have to use more of a knowledge base as opposed to a parser. So I think I don't have time, but next time we'll go over how to use the knowledge bases to use some creative applications and how to use some main.
Did you write your comments on the...